Hi, my name is Chris Kanansky. I'm the editor of the Des Moines Business Record. We're here today to have a discussion about culture in Central Iowa and how it intersects with business. One of the things that we often get an opportunity to do is to sit down and talk with business leaders and community leaders on some of these topics. And when we do that, we often come away with a lot of good story ideas and topics for us to write about in the future and things that people might be interested in. And so what we thought we'd do is, we've done this a few times now in the past, we bring in a group of leaders, we have a conversation amongst ourselves. Our goal is to come away with some story ideas, some things to write about for the future, and then also to put together a story for the paper. So we're going to adjust the camera right now, and from this point going forward, though, we're just going to have a discussion amongst ourselves. We invite you to be a fly on the wall and listen in on our discussion on culture with our great panel here today. And with us today, we have to my left, Chris Kramer, the Deputy Director of the Iowa Department of Cultural Affairs, Max Wellman, the General Manager of Noce. He's also a performer himself. Pete DeKock, the Executive Director of the Des Moines Social Club, been in that role for about a year-ish.
Just shy of a year.
We have Siobhan Spain, the Director of Mainframe Studios, and Sophia Ahmad, the Vice President of Public Relations at the Greater Des Moines Partnership, also a classically trained pianist, right?
All
right, so I'm gonna turn it over now at this point, this will be the last time we talk to the camera, to Perry Beeman. He's our Senior Staff Writer. He's been with us for about 3 years now. But he spent more than just about 30 years with the Des Moines Register reporting all about a number of topics in the Des Moines area. So from here, I'll turn it over to Perry.
Thanks, Chris. Well, I appreciate you all coming, and I think it's just a fantastic group for this topic. I mean, I can't imagine a better panel. So let's get right to it. And Sophia, maybe you can start off and we'll go down the list. My first question is, in your experience, what best illustrates the connection between culture and economic development?
Sure. So at the Greater Des Moines Partnership, we do think about this a lot and certainly see arts and culture as a way that ties into quality of life and helps us as a region retain and recruit talent here. So if Des Moines is a great place culturally and artistically and people are enjoying their lifestyle here, it's a great place to live and employers like to see that and it helps us in that way. So we really see that during economic development, talent pipeline. You may have seen in 2015, American for the Arts wrote an essay about Des Moines and lifted our region up as a leader, mentioned the Social Club, mentioned all sorts of different arts organizations as a leader in collaborating among businesses and organizations. On a personal note, as Chris mentioned, I am a pianist and my husband's actually a violinist, so we see that economic impact at home too, where he makes his living in Greater Des Moines as a professional violinist, which I think really says something about our community. Yeah.
Well, along those lines, to illustrate Sophia's point of the highlighting the culture of the community, I think a great example is what we experienced last night at the groundbreaking of the Carrie James Marshall monumental journey. So I loved going to that groundbreaking. I love that it's happening here.
Can you explain a little bit about what it is?
So it's a public art project by an internationally acclaimed artist that's happening right downtown. The groundbreaking was last night, and it honors the identity of Des Moines and how the National Bar Association was created here in 1925. So it's that culture of creating this public art to honor that history. It helps us better identify ourselves with our community and relate to each other and expand our horizons of who we are as a community. So even though that may not sound too connected to economic development, I think it speaks to what Sophia mentioned, is that if we are better and feel enriched about our community, that is a great asset to creating long-term economic viability. So, and more on a personal note with my work and my background, I think we're gonna see it, arts and culture and economic development come to life at Mainframe Studios. You know, art sparks the creative spirit, also innovation, and I think progress in economic and social interactions are spurred by the creative culture and the arts. So I'm excited about our project and what that will mean for the vitality in Des Moines, not just economically, but how we identify with our community and give space to all these great artists that we have.
And maybe on the top here, we should sort of establish where we're all coming from. Can you explain for the viewers Mainframe a little bit about what it is?
Yes. Yeah, so this is a project at 900 Kia Way. That's a 164,000 square foot building that used to be a Century Link building facility. So we are renovating it into permanent affordable workspace for artists of all disciplines. And I'm happy to say renovations have started. People will see the transformations with our new windows going in on the fourth floor, which is very exciting. So we did a demand study 5 or 6 years ago now, and there were 425 artists then that responded to our demand study that I think about 75% of them had no studio or working from their home. So that's an economic, untapped economic resource that we're giving them space, and in turn validating their profession, letting Des Moines know how many artists we have and how many disciplines that they're practicing. It's a very exciting project. So we are doing phase one. We hope to have some artists in maybe by April even. So watch for that transformation, physical transformations, and it's been an exciting process. One step at a time.
That's
it's happening.
Great. Give us a thumbnail on the social club for if someone out there doesn't know about it, and then tell us a little bit about the connection to social club in 5 minutes. Kind of a half an elevator speech.
Yeah, all right. It sort of defies that those kinds of constraints. I'll give it a shot. Social club, we believe in the catalytic power of art and culture to accomplish amazing things. Now, the community has been behind that idea now for a number of years, and I don't see that changing anytime soon. The momentum is still very strong. But I don't know if we all imagined exactly all of the things that would come out of that catalytic sort of explosion. We created as a community this space, 30,000 square feet in the middle of downtown, renovated an old fire station now to be this amazing venue with performance spaces that are as flexible as what our artists need them to be, are as warm and welcoming, as sound as good, and are as lit as well as our audiences want them to be as well. We've learned how to make this amazing space just a powerful environment where artists and audiences come together, and in that experience you start to see the beginnings of not only just people having fun, at the end of the day, we're talking quality of life and having fun is a huge part of that, but you also start to see people building friendships and relationships across difference or among people who they share much in common with, people who they wouldn't have had any other reason to come together with but for the awesome experience that they're all having right there with that art and that culture.
Is that in itself a way that maybe that networking helps economic development, do you think? I mean, these people form a variety of different relationships that might help? Or
I think, safely assume that it does, though I don't have a data plug to point back to on that. So let me tell you something that I can point to that's much more tangible for everybody who's thinking about how these things are connected. It's a story, actually, about the neighborhood that Max and I are both sort of living and working in over on the west side of downtown. Immediately north of the social club right now, our friends from Hubble are building a brand new facility. It'll be a market rate apartments. Immediately to our west, we've got city lofts, which are condos and apartments as well. But the Hubble story is fantastic because they are working in any number of corners and blocks here in Des Moines. But they chose specifically to get going on that one because they know there's an audience of people who want to live downtown and want to live next to an art and culture engine like the social club. So on top of that, they're not just building with proximity to the social club, without saying too much, they're also doing some amazing things to really build a creative building that is consistent with that focus on art and culture. You see that on every corner in that little section of downtown. I point to the Davis Brown building, any number of pieces of public art. Probably the most striking example of this would be what our friends from Come and Go are doing right now. So I'll wing this a little bit. I don't want to speak for all of those excellent people, but here's what I've heard when they've told the story. They have designed a building specifically to complement this amazing sculpture park that's over in West Des Moines. Our friends from Meredith do the same kind of thing. They want to be living in that space physically They want to be in that space with their employees and their associates as well. They understand that they need to complement that thing because, maybe the simple way to put it, there was an old idea maybe that people went where the jobs were. There's a newer idea that complements that. No, people don't go where the jobs are at. Jobs go where the people are at. And people want to be in neighborhoods like this. They want to work in environments that are surrounded by this kind of art and culture opportunity as well. And it's a huge challenge for everybody at the partnership, for everybody who's doing this privately, everybody who are state partners as well, to make sure that we're delivering on that part of sort of the equation, that part of the deal. Because if we don't create those kinds of spaces where people want to be, then the jobs aren't going to keep coming.
I'm going to take a question on this, because I think it's really interesting that during this time where the economy in general is doing better and we're able, come and go is able to say, we're not going to build just a building, right? We're going to go out and hire an Italian architect who's going to design something that's going to fit in from our perspective. It strikes me that back when I first started in 2009 during the recession, that maybe some of those decisions, people couldn't invest the way they might have otherwise done so in the arts. And so I feel like we're in this like really good time where we're able to make some of these investments that people might have shortchanged in the past. And that the job, you're saying that everybody, jobs go where the, or people go where the jobs are. That flipping that equation seems like right now people are in unemployment's so low, right? The general population is in a position where they have more choice in that sense, some of the things. So I'm just curious what your thoughts are on that dynamic and going forward. You know?
Well, we should avoid thinking in dichotomies and absolutes. That's not everybody who's worked on big thorny things like the social club, or big thorny things like a new business, or big thorny things like, building a new building, or any of the other really important work that's done here. And we should avoid those kind of gravitating to some of those sort of simple ways for thinking about this. And I'm not an economist who can speak authoritatively about why these kinds of investments were made now, when maybe we were capital rich versus other times. I think, though, that if you're building something like corporate headquarters, you're not building with 5 years in mind. You're not building with just the next sort of up and down cycle in the economy in mind. You're building with sustainability and longevity in mind. And what I see in that building is a profound statement that art and culture is not nice to have. It's not nice to have on the side. It's not just something that you do if you got extra money. It's something that is essential to building a sustainable business long time. It is essential to building a sustainable city that's going to be here and thriving for decades to come. There was a number, because we love lists, right? There was a number that came out recently about the projected city growth of the city of Des Moines relative to some of the other centers and population centers in the country. And I saw that number and I thought, that's going to be shocking if we get to, 3/4 million people in our region. That is an amazing amount of growth. But it will not happen just because we have momentum right now. It'll happen because we keep making smart investments. And some of those smartest investments, I think, that we've made in the past are in our arts and culture institutions as well. But I'm going to step back on this too, because really, as much as we want to invest from sort of businesses supporting the social club, the engines around here are a number of nonprofit organizations, but there are also a number of for-profits as well. Max, the folks at Noce, there are another big anchor sort of in our neighborhood as well. It's just a shockingly beautiful club that is bringing in highest caliber jazz musicians from around the country and around the world for that matter.
What a nice segue.
Thank you.
Well planned.
Yeah. Well, it is interesting to look at that issue from a private business standpoint. I think the original question was something about how business economic development is related to arts and culture, and I have never really looked at it as that being separate issues, even from the beginning of my own performance career, I was always very interested in trying to find a way to make music work as a viable business model. And we're putting that to the test on a larger scale now with Noce, which is just about a year old down on Wellman Street. But I think that, there are so many different levels to that question about the relationship between economic development and arts and culture in general. There's the nonprofit sector, which even though those models are set up not to be viable business models without some kind of charitable contribution, they make an enormous economic impact by the kind of catalytic effect that they have on the surrounding economic development. Like you were saying about the new buildings that are going up around the social club, around the sculpture park. It's crazy to me to think about that whole neighborhood, you know, even 10 years ago, versus after the sculpture park went in. There was a lot of work that happened, even that I'm aware of, and I am not aware of nearly all of it, that went into developing that neighborhood before the sculpture park went in. But once it did, due to some very generous charitable contributions, that has spurred so much growth around that space, and that's heavily impacted, definitely, by that park being there. You know, would Noce even be in that neighborhood if that park had not opened up? I don't know.
But in your view, what drives that? Why do people? You know, when the city worked on the sculpture park, I mean, it was a 15 or 20 year project to assemble that land, and the buzz from City Hall was, we put this in, there's going to be development. And I think it was easy to see that, but I think maybe it's happened more quickly than...
More quickly.
Well, why is that?
Well, it's a unique moment in Des Moines, Iowa right now, for sure. I see this as, this is probably overgeneralizing, but this era is a wonderful time to be a mid-major city like Des Moines, Iowa, when it comes to, I'm sure, business overall, but I see it through the scope of arts and culture because that's my world. I think there's a lot of different factors that go into that. You were referring to the recession. I know a lot of people around my own age who maybe grew up thinking they were going to move to LA or New York or Chicago and maybe weren't in a position post-recession to do that. And a lot of people stuck around the city that they had been in. And while that sounds like kind of a sad story on the surface, I think a lot of really beautiful things have happened because of it in places not only like Des Moines, but I went to school in Indianapolis, and that is a huge example of that, a whole generation of creative people who kind of stuck around by necessity and have in turn created a wonderful scene. We have that going on in our music scene here, definitely. And I consider myself a kind of a living example of that. I never saw myself being here for a long period of time, even having grown up here and loved Des Moines. But the way that I kind of sarcastically describe it to people is that it's harder and harder to leave because, in fact, there are wonderful opportunities here for young people in the creative world that maybe have never been here before. We have people who play down at Noce on a weekly basis who are, some of them are full-time musicians, which again was extremely rare. Even up until several years ago. A lot of them are doing other work in Des Moines, but are creatively fulfilled living here with their various projects that they have going on. And that's a neat new thing to see in the city. I've really wandered from the original topic.
I think your point is right, though. I mean, the space that allows something to happen, that's something that Zach talked about when he was starting the social club. Fact that he wasn't competing against the same things that he would have been in a larger city.
Absolutely.
Your ability to start the jazz club, you're not competing against another jazz club.
Right.
There's some space that allows you to start something.
Definitely. Now, I'm sure we'll get to this. I hope we do anyway. There are so many different pros and cons about that in our current landscape. You know, there's so much unprecedented work going on, which is great, but it's also, I don't know, scary is probably too negative of a word, but the way I would say it is, this is a very unique and wonderful moment where this city has an opportunity to kind of put a new stamp on its identity. You know, there's wonderful economic development in this area, and there's a chance to kind of pour some resources into supporting that arts and culture side of this city. And I'm encouraged by what I see currently, and I just hope we keep that momentum going, because it is a change that has to take place for people to see that as something that they value in a city that hasn't maybe had that much stuff going on in the past. You know, like, yeah, we open up a jazz club and it's either, wow, this is wonderful, there's no competition, I guess we're geniuses, or it's like, oh, well, also we see maybe some reasons why nobody was doing it, you know? So that's the line that you're always kind of walking in this new territory as an arts and culture scene in Des Moines, Iowa.
So Chris, the Department of Cultural Affairs lives this every day, and I'm interested in your perspective. You know, the Greater Des Moines Partnership obviously is looking at economic development every day. Max and Peter in an area, and we've got several panels here who are in areas that are sort of up and coming, may see the Wong Street corridor. What's your perspective on how those two things fit together, cultural and economic development?
So, Department of Cultural Affairs, we oversee a couple of different areas. We've got the Iowa Arts Council, we've got Produce Iowa, the reopening of the film office, which is just really thriving, and also the State Historical Society and Historic Preservation Office. And so, you know, our goal is really to build culturally vibrant communities. And the way that I might see those intersecting is that, you know, a lot of this is the financial aspect of it. You know, it's really important that we support in a lot of different ways, technical assistance, grants, and so forth, organizations so that they're healthy and sustainable. But that we also continue to guide them to success. And, you know, I think one of the reasons why people are willing to make that continued investment is when they see that success. So that really, you know, how does that look? It looks a lot of different ways. If you're a grant maker at a corporate, you know, foundation, you might be looking at somebody's financial statements to make that decision. But, you know, to the everyday person, that looks, you know, they want to know what's going on in my community. If there's a variety of offerings that are out there, there's artists coming in from out of state, some top-notch, you know, attractions, that type of thing, Broadway shows, you know, really cool exhibits, but also a lot of local talent. And this community is really grateful and appreciative of that mix and that blend. And I think that it's because of, you know, the decisions made by those before us and generations before us, that they were really committed to creating that great quality of life, all those wonderful attractions in our community, that, you know, they said, you know, we don't want to be the only ones supporting these. We want everybody to come. We want families. We want kids to enjoy these things. And it's because of their success that the next ones are able to be successful, because more people are willing to take the chance and more willing to go and attend, you know, the openings of shows, to go out and listen to live music and so forth. So it's really about, you know, success really does breed that continued success.
Oh, I was just gonna say, I might add to the conversation too that for viewers and readers who are interested in even more data, Bravo Greater Des Moines site and has really great resources. Was reading on there a little while ago, and I believe they have a 2014 study on the economic impact of Central Iowa's music industry, and yeah, showed some sort of impact of more than $65 million. And that takes into account all of the multiplier effects, et cetera, et cetera. But these are real dollars that we're talking about here. It's I think most of us as panelists can buy and stand for the altruistic meaning behind the arts and culture, and how central it is to our civilization and how long it's been that way. And also, we can point to those real hard numbers that
it's good business, too.
Exactly.
Do you find it's easier now to make that case about the importance of the arts than maybe it was 5 or 10 years ago? Is that more widely understood?
Maybe. Probably here it is, yeah.
I think that,
Or do you still run into some resistance?
I've done fundraising in this community for about 17 years and worked at the Science Center for 12 years. And it's always been difficult to measure the impacts that we've had. And so, it's always hard to say, what's the impact that an amazing painting, that's on exhibition at the Des Moines Arts Center, what's the impact of that? So we've really tried to do a lot of different calculations to quantify that. Numbers of participants, we've proved to Bravo and all the surrounding communities that we have people coming and attending and member families and so forth from the suburban communities and from those surrounding communities. And those are ways that we can do it, but we can't do that without telling those other stories of a visit to a science center or an art museum or a performance that's inspiring somebody to go into that and making that career choice down the road. So it's really important that we tell the full story, and businesses need some of those economic impact type of results to quantify and to basically back up those decisions. But it's always hard to say that public art is going to be worth the investment that you make into it until you go down there and you see it. And you see a huge crowd of people gathered around there and appreciating it and enjoying it and talking about it.
I just wanted to tag on to that real quick. I'm curious about what you guys think of this issue, but you mentioned something about how recognizing that development in the arts and culture community looks different on a more macro perspective from a corporation or a nonprofit that is giving grants out, stuff like that, and looks way different to the individual who's looking at things that are going on in their community. My feeling has been that we're making a lot of progress on those upper levels, of city officials seeing that this is an important thing and putting support behind it, organizations like Bravo, but maybe having trouble engaging more community by community in central Iowa, letting people know that this is a resource that they can draw on, that this stuff is going on in their community and is here. Do you feel that way with projects? People are shocked sometimes to find that this stuff is here.
Well, I think from our perspective, I think people are shocked to think that we can fill our building.
Right.
But we could twice over.
Right.
So I think that people will be pleasantly surprised about the impact that will have, but also the fact that it can happen here. We do have a vibrant creative culture here. I think in general too, not sure if it answers your question directly, but in general there's a movement of understanding that culture and focusing on what makes places unique really brings communities together, but also adds to the vibrancy. So I think that not just in Des Moines had the foresight to see that early on and build steps so we can be where we are today. But I think it is a national movement. There's a lot of talk, a lot of articles about that in general. So I think people are starting to get it from a lot of different angles, and not just Des Moines, but a lot of national articles about it. So I'm hoping that, we're setting a tone, an example. I've always said that Des Moines has been kind of a blank campus in a sense, that we've been patient, but there's also so much opportunity to, we know so much more now, as community planning and building, that we've been fortunate enough that we've made it this long, and been patient through the process and taking one step at a time.
I'd add to that is these thoughts about that. What do we measure? Can we measure the impact on this? One place where we can make some definite measurements is, what are the dollars that we're actually putting in the pockets of artists and creators? That's something that we can measure. And Max was talking about that with this amazing club that he and his team have got, and the dollars that they are specifically paying these artists, including a number of local artists who live here. And so to build on Siobhan's point here, when we're talking about another type of investment in the artists and creators, where we're actually building space now, where they can come and improve their craft, that's something we can very definitely measure as well. We can also, I hope we get a chance to talk about investments that we make in what I'll broadly call environment, and other investments we make in kind of cultivating and nurturing the audience of people who like this stuff. But when we're talking about the artists and the creators in particular, I want to raise one real critical question, or opportunity slash challenge facing all of us here in Central Iowa. Maybe it's just because I'm more recently from Chicago, but my hunch at the Social Club is that we are dealing with a massively sophisticated art and culture audience, and that if we are content with an idea of Des Moines good for the caliber of art and culture that comes into the city, we will all fail. We are dealing with audiences now that just don't think it's nice to have a chance to come and see a cool show at the Social Club. They want to see a great show. They don't care where it's at. We were talking earlier, I mean, all of us are moving around quite a bit. I'll be back in Chicago later tonight to go and do some fun things. We make trips frequently to other big population and cultural centers here in the Midwest and other parts of the country. I do that just as a course of living and enjoying, and that's how I live, but I would love to have that stuff right here so I can do it. But it's got to be hitting those high marks. And we should be pushed by our investors and by our audiences to keep hitting those higher and higher marks as well. And that doesn't mean just, all right, stay in the nice warm middle. Though that's great art and culture frequently as well when you're dealing with, for example, when Garth Brooks can come and sell out Wells Fargo Arena for an entire week, and we've got the professionals and the venues and the audiences engaged around that, we've done the marketing to build that up, that's lights out. That's really, really important. I want to make sure, though, whether we're talking about those types of things that are pretty established, but also talking about those things that are a little riskier, that are emerging, that are coming next, that are maybe already present in some of those bigger population centers that aren't here yet, that we're all working collectively to get them here fast and insist that they are hitting that high excellence level.
Oh, and I was going to say, too, I think Des Moines, too, has a great track record of having and demanding that excellence requirement, too. I think of when I was in graduate school for piano performance and literature, I knew about Des Moines just because of the Des Moines Metro Opera, because I had friends and colleagues who were auditioning for their apprentice artist program. I knew of Dr. Larson because he had edited the books that we were reading off of. So there's that, I mean, certainly that standard of excellence there. We look at Des Moines Performing Arts and what they're doing to bring in these national shows to the Civic Center, oftentimes before other cities that are significantly larger than ours are bringing them in. I hear about what guest artists say when they play with the professional musicians of the Des Moines Symphony Orchestra, and the kind of powerful, poignant experience that they're having, and more than 4,000 or 5,000 people on any given weekend are listening to Beethoven's Ninth Symphony, which, again, I think all of us around the semicircle can agree what that means in terms of a deep, true artistic experience, and certainly what that means for economic impact in terms of paid sales, in terms of corporate sponsorships and corporate support and community rallying. And the last one I'll say is, I'll think of the Arts Center, which, what a gem. I mean, as Chris mentioned, in our own community and the thoughtful, curated experience that they put on for their attendees. And I'll say too that when I first visited Des Moines, it was the Arts Center, and I really like the design of Juice Magazine too. the Arts Center that made me really think, oh my gosh, I can see myself living here, because we can intersect on this level. And now working at the partnership, that's the trajectory, that's the cycle that we're really interested in. Here you have perhaps somebody who's coming from another city thinking, I read that Politico article, How Des Moines Got Cool. Maybe I read about the Des Moines Social Club and about this regional collaboration that, I don't know if that happens in my own city. Then I visit and I see something like the Art Center and think, oh my gosh, there are like-minded people here. And then, you know, then the job, whatever that trajectory looks like, whatever order that looks like, but these are all pieces that work together to get people like those who want to move here to stay here and to live here.
Definitely.
I like the way you were kind of separating out between the people that are going to consume the content that you guys are all creating and the people that are having to make investments. And I think you were kind of alluding to it, but maybe it's harder to get the people. We can fill Garth Brooks can fill the arena for a week, right? And yet, I'm sure there's people that will enjoy music that would enjoy some of the jazz things, but that's risky. It's even riskier
totally.
As a participant to go to it, because if I'm not familiar with jazz, it could be a little hard.
And we were talking about this a little bit before the panel got started, but I see there's been this huge event-driven boom in the specifically, again, I'm going to talk about the music scene because it's what I know, but the number of festivals that go on and larger events that require music has just like gone off the charts from where it was when I first started doing music around here. And it is a great thing in that that is constantly money that is being spent within the music community, you know, on a weekly basis year round here. And that helps support artists, not maybe in the best, whatever. That's money that's going to artists. But I'm gonna try to bring together a couple of disjointed things here, because the point that we're talking about with, you know, Taylor Swift or Garth Brooks comes in town and sells the stuff out, or the Broadway shows that are so successful at the Civic Center, that there's a lot of things that go into that, and there are good, very good plans that are being executed to make sure that that happens. But it also shows me, you know, I hate the argument as a programmer that there isn't support, generally speaking, for arts and culture in this city, because it's like, you know, numbers-wise, the number of people who go out to things like that throughout the year is very large. But the smaller piece of this cultural scene is not maybe getting out in front of people. There are still so many people who, when they think of theater in Des Moines, they think Civic Center, you know, and maybe that's like where it stops. Rather than thinking then also about, well, maybe we'll check out a musical or a play at the Repertory Theater of Iowa or Stage West, or even the Des Moines Playhouse. You know, it's just a kind of disconnect that's happening, I would say, probably across the cultural scene at large in the city. There's untapped potential for audiences, and that also means that's untapped potential for business growth in the city.
One thing I want to make sure that we address and kind of gets into this, I mean, it's such a broad topic, but jazz, for example, it's out there, it's all over town. I always thought when, you know, Sophia was busy with Juice and mm-hmm. registered date book listings and everything, if you read the listings, there was a lot going on.
7 nights a week.
But they weren't all on Walnut Street.
No.
They weren't all downtown in a small area. And we could say that, I mean, the Social Club basement is the coolest thing you ever got. Mainframe coming in with these artist studios. Those are the types of things I think the Land Des Moines and these articles we're talking about and the ratings that are kind of surprising. But think of it in a way of critical mass and branding. That's fine, we all know that. People looking here might find that out. Sophia found out about the opera, wasn't even here yet.
Yeah.
But do we need it? Do we suffer because Walnut Street isn't this just park the car and go to 12 different clubs?
Yes.
Talk about that a little bit.
Well, one quick thing that has always really interested me, I love that you mentioned the opera, because I've worked with them for years, and I jump at the opportunity to work with them, because it is an absolutely just stellar organization that works by their own standards and does world-class work. And because of the work that they do, there are years where the majority of their ticket buyers for their summer festival come from outside of the state to go and see the productions there, which is impressive. And but it's also kind of sad because there are people in Iowa who, you know, have no idea that it's there.
Should that be on Wellman?
Well, I don't know. I mean, I think we have an opportunity maybe to consolidate things a little bit with the downtown development that's going on. But I would say the larger issue is just awareness. There are people that come into Noce all the time who are fans of jazz and blues music, who go to the Civic Music Association series, for instance, who are checking out the club for the first time, and they're blown away by someone like Tina Hospinley or Susie Majet. And they'll come up to me after the show and say, where are they from? And, you know, they will have been living here for two decades. And I'm like, this is, I am so glad that you heard her, but, you know, this is too bad, too. I mean, how have you not heard that?
Well,
you
know,
I was just going to say, too, I think some of it kind of segues into market segmentation and kind of some different aspects of that. So I'll use the Des Moines Symphony as an example because they were my former employer. But so more than 100,000 people attending the Des Moines Symphony Sankey Tuggle Pops on the beautiful West Terrace lawn of the Iowa State Capitol. Some of them might ask, well, why doesn't the symphony have 100,000 people coming to the Civic Center to hear the Enigma variations? And someone might say, well, first of all, the capacity is a little different. Mm-hmm. Second of all, it's a different audience, and it's a very different experience. When people are on the West Terrace of the Iowa State Capitol, they have their picnic baskets, they're listening, they're enjoying the atmosphere. It's a very, very different experience than sitting in a concert hall and taking in this breathtaking piece of living art, right? The other thing I might say to that, too, is I think that organizations, too, are taking steps in those directions. So I think about the Des Moines Metro Opera, for example, with their second stage series, just had a production over at the Science Center that we're looking at right now. And I think perhaps at the Social Club, maybe. but they're, I think they're reaching out into thinking about different areas. Some of that, too, is just that it takes time to develop an audience. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So to get that, the jazz lane, the Walnut Street jazz lane,
I like that.
It might take, you know, Max's expertise to cultivate that audience for a few years.
The Shakespeare on the lawn thing, I've never read Shakespeare. I have no interest in that, right? And we went to it, and I was begrudgingly went to it. But we sat outside, and it was really interesting, and then I finally got to actually experience it. I was like, oh my God, how have I not listened to Shakespeare? How have I not watched Shakespeare? Have I not done this before? And like, now I want that more, and I had never had that experience before. And so, that's an example of like, you made it into an event. It wasn't just going to the theater.
That's the also. Event thing, too.
What's the shape and characteristic of our audience today? We're all competing for limited number of dollars and limited number of hours with all of these folks who potentially could be coming to our spaces. I think the competition actually is really important. I think it pushes us all to keep delivering better and better product. But to put it bluntly, if you're gonna go to watch a major college football game or buy season tickets to that, or you're gonna go to an NFL game or any other kind of sporting event, another kind of cultural attraction we're competing against, even one game there for a family is a $500, $600, $700 adventure. But what if Des Moines is a community where people say, I'm going to forego going to that one game, and then I'm going to spread that $500 investment out across going to five dinners in a show, it's 10 dinners in a show. That's the kind of attitude that we're talking about culturally that we're trying to cultivate in this audience. And it's going to take a shape that's unique to Des Moines. I think it's improving as all of us have sort of been nodding our heads, people have been sort of pointing to this. And ultimately that is going to be the litmus test about whether or not this is sustainable. Are we giving the people what they want? Sort of like what the OJ sang about, right? It's sometimes as simple as that. But there are some policy and some business investment decisions that we can make right now that I think put us on a footing so that we can keep making those types of cultural strides. If we agree that this is important, if we agree that this type of cultural vibrancy is important, then some of the policy changes we need to consider are, how much do we invest in creating events that utilize the public space, for example, for free? So we'll point to awesome events like 8035. There's a fee, but it's a pretty nominal fee for using the streets in the city of Des Moines. The city of Des Moines and all of its partners say, let's get behind this because tens of thousands of people are coming to the middle of downtown, and it's an amazing event. We get behind those kinds of events. How do we likewise then get behind our venues? How do we likewise get behind a Noce? How do we likewise get behind the social club as well? They're not, you know, we aren't doing things that are event-driven. We're doing things that keep that steady drumbeat going.
That's a very good point of kind of tying those things together. Because I think that, you know, last month I went to the Chicago Jazz Festival, and I've been a couple times to that. It's a wonderful festival, and it's free for people to go to, and they pack it out. But they make sure through that whole week to, you know, there's like the first two nights of the festival, they do a free trolley tour of like 12 different venues. And you stop and get off for like just a tiny little bit, and there's maybe a really cheap drink special going on. But they're trying to like expose people to like, oh, this is here, and maybe you can go next weekend. And push that local side of it while they're also bringing the best acts from around the world for people to go and see.
Well, I also think that it's the attention given to these events, like the NFL. Mm. Advertising, it's in front of us. There's a lot of coverage, media coverage and advertising that goes into that. Where's the platform for the local arts and culture? It's one thing that I've seen missing since I've been here, and hope that it keeps continuing. It's like the art reviews, let's have a story about, you know, going to Shakespeare, having different platforms for communication about these, that is, I think, sorely missing.
Yeah, absolutely.
Our community. And where are the writers that can write about this? There's not, I don't know, there's a motivation because there's no platform for writing about it. But there's been efforts for sure, even a calendar listing that everybody tries to tweak it to make it a little bit more effective, you know, to get people there.
So then there's like 17 different calendars.
The conversation, where is the conversation? You know, arts writing is not funded, you know, and it's inevitable. It will happen here. We are going to have a sustainable arts and culture community, but how is that going to happen? I've started conversations with people like, where's the baby steps that we can get more dialogue, more cross the communication about it, and connect.
You talked once about Chicago having critique, right?
Right.
And not maybe not that necessarily having that. You'll do a better job summing that up for than I will if you give that kind of overview on the differences.
Well, all of us feel it, right? Because this is an important part of communicating with these audiences, so it can be platforms where we get a chance to economically say, this great show is coming up and you should come and see it. So a little deal to all the venues or all to the events or the places where we're putting on shows where we've got an outlet that says, we're gonna give you a financial break so you can tell this really compelling story, or we're gonna do a great piece about what's coming up, similar to the way that you know, Business Publications has done that on a number of different platforms as well. We're deeply appreciative of that. Mm-hmm. But there is, beyond that, another sort of critical element. And Des Moines not, I don't think, feeling this uniquely. This is a massively disrupted space. And we don't have the old weeklies and the newspapers that have the resources to cover this the same way as they have in the past. We're searching right now for what those new outlets are going to be. Music, I think, gives us some sense of where we might be going. In Des Moines right now, we've got a number of really, really good blogs that write really interesting stuff, not just about, hey, this is coming up, sort of
right.
Giving an in-depth on both calendars.
Girth to it.
Real girth. And this kind of gets back to the excellence point, too. You know, our artists want, they may not want it in their face, but they want critique.
They do.
They want feedback because they want to improve their craft. They want to improve their artistic process. They want to give the people better and better stuff. Get that when you have a lot of this peer-to-peer and a lot of this great art criticism that's going on as well. Somebody who's going to come out and say, you know what, these folks just blew it up on stage. We've got any number of shows that are coming up at Social Club, more shows than any number of platforms can really cover effectively, or just so much content. from our standpoint, we've got to keep doing a better job of pointing to those where we want those few art critics that are out here to come and take a look at it, make it easy for them to get there, but then we also need to have a big way of helping them get that story out once it's done.
I may also add too, it's a great audience development tool because you see these reviews posted on Facebook, so you read Imogen's Washington Post, you know, review of a symphony concert, and then you see the comments. Well, you know, actually, I thought that the first violin sounded great in that section, and actually, I thought that the woodwinds could have come out more in this part. I mean, that's community building right there, right? And then you want to go back with those people to the next performance to experience it again and talk about it afterwards, right?
Just like the Kerry James Marshall, going back to that, there is a story in the New Yorker about it. It's like, you know what? It's read about it to find why this is significant about the artist. It engages you with the community more than just to have them a calendar listing. It's like, actually,
right.
You learn about
the significance
of it. Learn about the story of why this particular artist was chosen, why the design was chosen, you have more information, you feel more engaged with it. And you're able to discuss with your neighbors about it. It creates this community.
It does, but I think that, you know, to your point, that got national attention, and that's great, but not everything is going to get that national attention, and I think it's always about that mix. And it's about audience development and knowing where they're getting their information, and you know,
we just don't have that here. Nobody talking in that regard about that.
But I think it's also finding that way and saying, okay, instead of being everything to everybody, you know, if it's within audiences to find out, you know, really focus on their targets, whether it's adults or young professionals or what have you, or you know, families with kids and so forth. But, you know, and to be sharing with those communications. It's difficult for, you know, 60 organizations in this community to each go out with their one voice. But if you can be more collective in the way that you approach your communications, it will have a much greater impact. An example of that, years ago, we, you know, the Science Center and the zoo had a membership program. And it was very limited and so forth, but it was the same audience. And we really tried to expand that and expand it to also include living history farms. And you know, we were able to promote that to families and introduce them to these three major cultural institutions in our community. And you know, that's important because when you have somebody become a member, you're teaching them to give, you're teaching them to support the organization, to buy a ticket and so forth. And to feel more comfortable with paying for the attractions or the tickets and so forth. But it's also about that constant audience development. And you know, one of the great things about our community, you know, we've talked about this a little bit, is our corporate support. And you know, not only are these major employers like Meredith, who's been here for more than 100 years, and Principal and Pioneer, not only are they charitable and giving in this community, but they also represent a group of people who are willing to support their community. There are 80,000 people who commute to the downtown area every day, Monday through Friday. And you know, I think one of the reasons why, Max, your experience that I didn't know this was going on here is that, you know, think about this. When I first moved here 17 years ago, I was driving around going, where is everybody? And you know, I couldn't figure out why in the downtown there weren't any people on the streets.
So
and it's because of the skywalks. And the skywalk system was really important to this community to provide, you know, and I think the employers have really listened to understand that having, you know, great things at the street level, everything from Court Ave and you know, all the different areas, you know, Court Avenue a few years ago, it was just a bunch of bars, and now it's an epicenter. East Village, look at East Village today. And those are the ways that, you know, it says come downtown, and don't just come during the week, but come back.
Right.
Come back at night, and when the doors are open on a spring night, and you can hear music coming out of all of these different you know, all the different smaller places and larger places, it says, wow, I didn't know this was going on. And so, you know, we have to just continue to reach out. The corporations are a really good vehicle for us to reach out to, and
definitely,
you know, inviting people down and saying, come back in the evening and on the weekends.
Let me ask you about the people who aren't in town, though. I mean, you look at those two groups. We want people to stay here. We want them to know what's here. So when, how do we get from the point where people come to Des Moines and they keep telling us they're surprised and they can't believe the social club, they can't believe Noce and everything they're seeing, to knowing that Des Moines is like that, you know, as a way of, as a matter of image? You know, we talked about publicity and everything, but any ideas on what we do in the way of, we've got to catch Des Moines, but I mean, it's...
And that's a great start. I do think that, what you're talking about kind of consolidating that message and getting more unified as a creative scene is a very sorely needed thing. But truly, I just think more of that kind of thing has to happen. People don't have the idea. When you're talking about we're all competing for the same amount of people going out to things and spending money on things, I think that there's an opportunity actually to greatly expand that number of people because there better be, because otherwise there has been all of this growth creatively in this city for various reasons. But we need to expand the audience a little bit, or else as a city, we'll have missed that opportunity.
If I come in for a business meeting from Denver, do I know about Noce and the Social Club?
That's a good question.
How hard is it for me to know that there's actually a scene here?
Well, I can answer that definitively yes, with the partners that we work with. And that's part of our business model.
You're so sure.
Well, it's a part of our business model where we specifically engage our partners and work up, and this is a benefit of our nonprofit status, right? We can work closely with them to tailor their investments in the social club so that it creates opportunities then for that kind of scene that they want to create. Great example of this, Principal has been enormously generous to any number of different institutions, but they got a tough spot, right? They got to go and compete against Fidelity, for example, out of Boston, to get these enormously talented people that, as I said before, the jobs are going to go where the people want to be. People want to be on the coasts, overwhelmingly, but increasingly we're able to tell a compelling story about why people want to be here in the Midwest and our mid-sized cities as well. That's the story Principal's trying to tell. So when they go out and they recruit a number of these very diverse and extremely talented interns with knowledge that they specifically need to be able to do this enormously specific, important business that Principal does, they bring them to the social club and say, that cultural vibrancy that you're feeling in Boston or that you feel in San Francisco or in Los Angeles, we're not trying to duplicate that, but we've got that in our special Des Moines way as well. And people come down and have fun. So when we have our big fundraiser at the social club this spring, there's a table full of principal interns that are there. And these are really, so we can be intentional about that. Now, does that add up to the bigger kind of cultural and habit changes we're talking about in our audience? No, and habits change slow, and they are the process of many, many years of grinding and trying and keep delivering the really great art and culture. There are things we can do to accelerate that, but my own hunch right now is that in this community right now, we have a certain number of people who, they're into it. They're into the art and culture scene, whatever form that might take. Can we dramatically change that cultural and add to that with the people that we have here right now? That's a tough and expensive prospect. Will the number grow, though, as the city grows, just as that diversity of the people come in and the people who are already sort of wired for this are getting a great first touch and decide to make their art and culture and win a habit of their living here in art and culture? Yeah, I think that can certainly happen. But either way, whether it's converting people who are already here right now or catching those people who are coming in at start, it's still a long term. We're playing a long game on that.
You touched on an interesting thing about comparing to other communities, which I found the last several years here happens more and more. It's like Des Moines is the next insert much larger city here, which is kind of ridiculous. Like, the intention is very good, but I can't tell you how many times someone has asked me, you know, how do we get like Austin? And I'm like, well, we're not Austin. It's not, I think those kind of arguments are missing the point and actually are part of the issue that we're talking about here, which is that there are unique and wonderful things to this community that have not really been capitalized on to make Des Moines, Des Moines. Point of this panel discussion, it sounds like a lot of crying about, you know, not enough attention being paid to these efforts, and I don't mean to make it totally sound like that. There's definitely great things going on, and I think the big point is just that if we can kind of shift a little bit more energy, a little more attention to this, it would be great for the entire city, certainly downtown development.
And I think it would attract people not just wondering what's happening here if they happen to be here from Denver on a business meeting, but people from Omaha actually saying, hey, let's go to Des Moines this weekend, Kansas City,
totally.
Minneapolis. I think that's what that's what I go to those communities for.
Mm-hmm.
But anywhere you go, you're gonna have that challenge of Bemis Art Center, for instance, they have the same instance, like their neighbors aren't aware that they're internationally known. They've got this amazing program that's been in Omaha for years. So there's always gonna be an element of that. But it's starting with just with our region, you know, and I think the arts and culture are really great, local arts and culture. What can't they get in Kansas City? What can't they get in Omaha? And I think we're doing a really good job at embracing what makes Des Moines unique, and we have plenty to do that.
As we go down that path, we have about 10 to 15 minutes left or so. I'm wondering if you guys have some thoughts and some ideas on some, and maybe it's twofold. Maybe it's is there something we should be doing right now, something short term that you guys would recommend that, or some things that people could start working on? Or, and longer term, are there some long term goals that we should be thinking about, or some, whether it's something physical or an idea? I'm just curious to, as a general little brainstorm, curious what you guys would come up with.
I would echo, I think that we have great, great momentum, and certainly the partnership recognizes that. And one of our strategies that we continue to build upon is just embracing that community pride. I mean, with all of the different campaigns that we do in terms of uplifting downtown and making those connections between economic development and quality of life and arts and culture to help foster that understanding that it's all tied together. I'll give one quick example, walkability and navigation downtown. The reality is that we have more than 40 development projects happening downtown, including Mainframe Studios, and this is a great, great thing for our city. And also a reality is that perhaps the sidewalk you used to use is now being used by a construction crew. So how do we help get people around downtown in a way that in a way that they can't get around downtown, and introduce them to perhaps a different mode of transportation that they're not used to taking, like the D-line or one of the B-cycle bikes or walking or what that might be. And yes, and how do we make that interesting and fun and culturally connected? Well, the art route is a really great example of that, which is connecting these works of public art with art to help encourage that from a mobility standpoint, and also make it fun and interesting. And this is one of those talking points that we, as an organization, can use when we're talking to members of the national media to say, hey, this is another thing that really does make our community distinct. Every city has people who move in it, right? So that's not necessarily distinct, but this is something that we're doing where we're a national leader in.
I think another one is, you know, we need to continue to partner with our CBB and state tourism office, because they're, you know, they're always hungry for content and they want to push those stories out. You know, it's challenging for them, I think, to get the word out to the many different mediums that exist today. And that's one of the challenges that we're just facing as a society in general. But continuing to partner with them so that they're aware of what's going on, so that, you know, they still do the tours of their employees and volunteers that work in the tourism bureaus, but also at the hotels, so that when somebody does come in to town, that those people at the front desk are able to say, oh yeah, you should check out this new jazz club, or you should check out this thing. I think another thing we have to continue to support is, you know, the organizations that we've already committed to as a community. because when Des Moines Performing Arts brings in, you know, some of the top-notch Broadway shows, that's a win for all of us. Whether somebody's coming in, driving in from a small town, and you know they're coming from Mason City, Iowa, or Burlington, and they're going to stay for the weekend, or they're coming in from out of state. And oftentimes we get shows here that before a lot of the communities around, because if they're going to come, then they also want to go out to eat. They want to go. These are right. Oftentimes people want to listen to live music. They want to go to a show, go to the farmer's market and see some of the live performances that are going on there. So, you know, those are leaders for us that can help us draw people to our community. Then once those people are here, we can really turn them on. And then, so again, it's those partnerships, even with our local population. You know, and as a state, you know, we're really uncovering all the hidden treasures across the state, all the great things that are going on. But you know, a lot of people from rural communities come to the city for things. So they may be a bit surprised still about all the great offerings that are going on here. And so, you know, it's a continued momentum that we have to share everything that's going on and get the word out. And you know, like you said, I've been here for 17 years and I've seen so much change and happen, and it's exciting to see. You know, I remember when Gateway West was just an idea, and with all the, you know, the broken down buildings all around there, when it was just an idea. And so with the success of things like, you know, bringing online the new library that's been there now for 12, 13 years,
yeah.
Science Center, World Food Prize, the Principal River Walk, which has been a wonderful addition to our community, but now all the ancillary things that have happened in here too. So in a way, it's kind of like, oh no, that success that we were talking about, it's happening, what do we do next?
Right, that's
so
a good point.
That's exciting too.
Totally.
And now we've got Mainframe Studios mm-hmm. coming online. You know, for me, not only do I wanna see all these artists have a place where they can unite and do things, but selfishly, I wanna go buy their art. I want places that, you know, now go into the next stage of that is the retail economy that can go along with that. So, you know, it's just thinking about what's next. And we've also, our community has talked about a mid-size music venue, so that might be something that's worth further exploring. Also, our state's flagship museum is in need of an upgrade. And, you know, those serve as iconic experiences to draw people to our community so that once they're here, then we can turn them loose.
The overwhelming challenge that I see community-wide on the level of business that Noce does is that we have had a lot of growth, and there's new stuff happening all the time. And this is new for Des Moines at the same time that the media landscape is completely changing all over the country. Mm-hmm. And it is just a kind of unfortunate coincidence that is happening at the same time, because at the same time that we perhaps needed more coverage and support for awareness for a lot of these things going on, there's in fact a lot less. And I think immediately that's the most pressing issue on a local arts scene that I see play out on a week-by-week basis. But it is a good challenge to have many of the challenges that we have in front of us, because it is undisputably true that, you know, progress is being made and exciting things are happening.
I want to add very briefly that two things, just from a music, I'm wearing my musician's hat now, but I remember reading Robert Schumann, the German Romantic composer, had this music journal, the New Zeitschrift for Music, like the new newspaper for music, basically, where he had all this music criticism. And in it, he bemoaned the demise of classical music and how this flashy other composer, possibly by the name of Liszt, was like this wild star and stealing all the thunder and like doing all these crazy, wild, out-of-the-box things. And whenever I come back to that and I read that, and I think whenever I feel from a musical perspective and an artistic perspective that the ground is moving under me, I think, well, Robert Schumann was experiencing a similar thing, you know, a couple of years ago. The other thing I might add is those millennials, what to do with those millennials,
oh,
right?
Oh, stop it.
those
Don't get me started.
So,
So, but we, here's the cool
we
thing.
We have a band name, but it's not appropriate.
One of the great things about these millennials, from what I understand, is one of their behavior traits is that they love a live experience. So in fact, there's this new tech, or there's this new like company or system that's set up that is basically like Uber for classical musicians. So you can book a quartet and they'll come to your to a venue and you can assemble a group of people and have this live musical experience. And so how cool and how hopeful is that, right? That in an age where technology is changing and people are consuming information in different ways perhaps, that there is still that this young generation that wants that really intimate live experience that I think is great for the arts.
Yeah. I think the disruptions here that we're talking about with how we tell these stories to connect audiences, you mentioned Franz Liszt. First time I heard that famous piece by him was in a Bugs Bunny cartoon. Uh-huh. Right. So there's a great example of a disruptive piece of technology from another time with animation, who then continued a type of art form that exposed it to a completely different audience. We talk about apps that we can use to book audiences. We talk about an app like Bands in Town that tell you based on what's in your playlists and what's on your record collection already when that band might be coming. So yeah, we're all feeling quite a bit of disruption around how we connect with audiences and how we tell these compelling stories. Some of it can be fixed by better sharing information, creating common platforms. I want to reemphasize what Max was talking about. We need still tastemakers. We need people who are saying this is good and this isn't. You should pay attention to this. That's really important as a step. When I'm thinking about all those opportunities and growth edges for us, I also oftentimes will break it up in sort of into three pieces. We've been talking a lot about audience. That's a real core piece. For me, it starts with the artists, though. That's where our conversation started, where we talk about what investments do we make in the creatives and the artists who are actually creating these live performances frequently that are really valuable right now, especially among musicians. How do we start with them and invest in them and make it easier for them to thrive here? A couple ideas. The biggest thing I hear from musicians especially is that they don't need access to somebody who's going to produce their record. They don't need access to a recording space. They can go and find those. They need capital. What would it look like for us to start a fellowship that's funded by any number of sources here in town that says, great musicians across the genres, come and compete to have a $30,000 grant, a fellowship for the year. You will play as sort of artist in residence in Des Moines. There'll be certain other outcomes that you have to deliver throughout the course of the year. You're going to play a lot of different venues, but we're going to make it possible for you to take that next step in your career as an artist, whatever that step might be, convinces. Capital, that's a huge thing when we're talking to artists. I see that we were making those kinds of investments. I think we can make even additional investments in that.
And so the Arts Council actually started a fellowship program 2 years ago, and we've had now, we're in our third group, and you know, albeit that we've had five each year in each class, but now, you know, this has been tremendous to invest in these folks, and they do get a very sizable stipend that allows them to just go and develop their work and develop their skill set and exposure, and they're mentored. So they're able to really develop the skill set to be a successful business person along with being an artist. And so more of those, it's a great model, and the Iowa Arts Council put together a great model, and it'd be a great one to duplicate in our local community.
Yeah. So I love that, and that's something that's accessible to everybody in Iowa. There's a chance for Des Moines to differentiate itself, though. What about a Des Moines-specific fellowship? That would be a pretty cool model. And I can think of any number of organizations that might do it.
I think flipping that a little bit also, I do still think there should be... this has happened in a lot of ways across our indie music scene in Des Moines, which, again, going back to another point, you can definitely trace this development to some of those festival-led efforts, you know, several years ago. Great bands have come out of Des Moines through that scene, whether it's Max Jury or Christopher the Conqueror or any number of groups that have enjoyed now national success. That happened because there was then a spotlight kind of shone on those artists, and it was like, these are, you know, Des Moines artists, and you should check them out. And I think that there's an opportunity to kind of expand that to our wider arts and culture scene.
They're not just Des Moines good, too. They're just flat out.
Well, that's what I mean.
Good.
Good, and they're from here, and we can be proud of them.
Yeah.
And the venues along with that, and just the whole scene. You know, clubs comparable to Noce in, say, Kansas City, they don't have marketing budgets because it is a thing that people do in Kansas City to go out and hear jazz music. Now, I'm not saying, like, that's what we should be like, but it is worth looking at what makes these communities intrinsically value this stuff so that then businesses can open, people can pursue their own craft and, you know, make money for the city while also having this awesome thing.
I'm guessing you are seeing some new faces in Noce and the social club basement for the jazz shows, though. I mean, because it feels like things are growing and people are kind of feeling a little bit more like, boy, Sherman's got, seems like it has a lot more going on.
Definitely.
Your venues, you talk about the middle-sized venues, maybe we need more. We have some, you know, people want to talk about the outdoor venues. But I'm guessing you do see some people who maybe aren't
yes.
hardcore jazz.
We keep very specific track of who comes in each week and how many new people we're seeing. And still going, you know, 50 plus weeks strong, it's over 80% of our customers on a daily basis are new. And that's a cool kind of thing. It shows me again, though, that you know, these people are having great experiences and we're bringing new people into that cycle. But how do we get people to think of this as more of a regular thing? I just got off work. I work in Des Moines, Iowa. I'm going to go and find something to do, you know, rather than just that kind of commuter lifestyle.
Your fellowship idea, would you, in that idea, and I know it's just thrown out there, but would that be limited to people here, or could you use that as a tool to bring in outside talent and try to attract people from New York City that aren't getting the, are having some trouble getting the attention that they might otherwise get here?
I'm not a musician myself to say what would we draw by putting that carrot out there. My hunch, though, is that because touring is such a big part for musicians now, or even for visual artists that are looking to go to places where they know there's already sort of an audience and people that appreciate this, visual art-wise, or just a community of artists, they can give that kind of critique. The one can check the box on all that. We can say that you got it. So I can imagine that something like this, the lure of that kind of capital and that kind of freedom, could attract hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of applicants from all over the country, probably applicants from around the world as well.
I think it's along those lines. You know, with our project, there's a lot of discussion and hope for an artist in residency program. And I do think it's essential to lift up the local talent, but also expose to a national level too. That's where we get that talent development, that exposure, that motivation. So it's a complement to our community to bring in outside artists for residencies or fellowships as well. I think the Iowa Arts Council Fellowship does a great job of the local market, and it works really well. I know a lot of those artists that have gone through that. It's really impacted their lives and their practice. They've been able to develop their practice. And that does impact economic development in the long run. So I think that a mix of it is good. I think if we're too much in a bubble, we are not maybe progressing the way
it doesn't build the brand. Yeah.
Yeah, so I think there's a lot of opportunity to that. I think there's also, you know, what I've seen in the town is a need for more agents for art. So it could be writers, it could be more galleries, you know, in Des Moines, like for our size, for visual arts, that's my background. That is a big gap in our community, which I hope to find that there's a growth in that area so people can actually have a solid career in their arts. And it means agents for art. So it's venues, it's writers, it's curators, it's all that good stuff. And one last thing, I think another gap that I've seen in Des Moines is just the inclusion. You know, we are very inclusive, but how do we take the extra step to really reach out to the neighbors that we haven't really worked with, because there's a lot of arts and culture organizations out there that aren't normally at the table, and I think that our community in general will benefit greatly by mixing it up a bit and acknowledging all the people and all the culture that we have here.
Let me just jump in real quick, because I know we're running out of time, so you've gone a little bit over. I appreciate just a fantastic discussion. Let's go around one last time and take maybe like 30 seconds apiece and just kind of give us a parting thought, whether it's something you want to stress that you've already said or something you haven't had a chance to lay out there. Chris, parting thoughts?
Well, I think, you know, one of the reasons why we are doing so well in this community is that we have great quality of life. And I think it used to be true that people wanted to live on the coast or be around all that stuff, but you know, the Midwest communities really are thriving, and Des Moines is knocking it out of the park. And you know, we're busy people because we choose to go to all of these wonderful things that are going on in this community. And I'm just excited that we are at this time in our community, and we're able to build upon everything that's happened in the past. You know, it's because 50 and 60 years ago that some of our community leaders said, boy, we really need that in this community, and they were willing to put forth the plan and their own reputation to say it's important enough for my community to have this here. And you know, hopefully there are enough continued leaders to have that courage to say, you know what, we need to continue to invest in all of this, because it's important not only for those people in our circle, but all people in our community. So, you know, and I'm always a big fan of supporting things for kids, and you know, the more we can expose children to all of these things, all of these opportunities, that's going to be how we're going to continue to carry that legacy forward.
There are a lot of things that I feel are really special about Noce as a project, but I'm extremely biased, and there are two things that I kept going back to when we opened that were so, seemed so full circle to me. Bob and Maria Philippone own that building and that business, and they are not from Des Moines, Iowa. They moved here with their family and saw it as, yes, a great place to raise their children and have a family, but then also saw great opportunity in the arts and entertainment culture that was growing here, and have stayed here and put money back into the community to try and make a thriving business here, which is a cool kind of testament to the things that are going on. And then they found me to come in and try and run that for them, someone who was a performer raised here that, you know, now I'm staying here and doing that. And now I see that building as a place to then put musicians in Iowa to work on a weekly basis. And that's a great cycle that has started that is taking place in a lot of different efforts. I just think that we gotta be careful now to like keep moving the ball forward and push that message out there and let people know that there is wonderful stuff happening here for you to enjoy. It'll be great economically, culturally, and everything. All will be well.
Yeah. I think we benefit from a good inertia right now. As people keep coming to the community for many important reasons, we keep drawing more and more folks who want to be in a culturally vibrant place. The audience that sustains so much of our activities, the artists who it all starts with, they are coming here in bigger numbers all the time, and they're finding when they get here too, the sort of the third piece of the triangle. They've got these environments, these performance spaces for live performance or for any other types of performance. They're finding all of the pieces are present here in Des Moines. What are some things that are immediately in front of us that we can do to now really continue to differentiate ourselves as a place that is awesome for creatives and awesome for audiences that love this stuff? I do think this capital in artists is a really important piece of it. And it also gives us a chance to really drive home the point, not just artists who are exploring this as a craft or exploring this as something in their careers, but
These are people who are established. These are artists that are exceptional. These are artists that are doing field advancing stuff. Des Moines is a place where they can come and do that kind of work. Capital is frequently what stands between them and doing more and more of it. Let's solve that capital problem here in Des Moines, or take a crack at it and differentiate ourselves from some of these other organizations. On the environment front, I do think right now there is a real strong tradition here and culture around these big festivals, and we need to keep massively investing in that. I want to see those 80-35 numbers go up year over year over year, and I want to see Hinterland, and I want to see 515 Alive, and I want to see all of those other smaller kind of showcase events like we do at the Social Club, or can do it so with the Social Club and Noce together. I want to see those continue to thrive. But underneath that, I want to see stronger building stones, building blocks, where you've got those venues, those performance spaces that are solid, that are providing those week-to-week opportunities for artists to come and improve their craft and come and connect with audiences, and places that audiences especially come to know that, yeah, like I said, I can go spend that $500 watching Chiefs play in Kansas City, or go watch the Cyclones and the Hawkeyes play. That's a great time. But I'm not going to go to one of those weekends. I'm going to put that money in my pocket instead and say, that's $500 I'm going to use to go have a great meal and come see a great show as well. Making that kind of progress around shaping the sort of cultural consumption norms in this audience, that's really key. And it's not in that sense, I'm not waiting for all those people who are coming, and I'm not talking about all those people who live in surrounding communities that can come. I want them, and they come, and they're great. But the bulk of my audience lives in Des Moines, in all its neighborhoods, and all the surrounding suburbs. And I'm very proud of the fact that at the Social Club, our accessibility for anybody in this community to come and have be a part of that is massive. And I can point to the data that shows every neighborhood, every city is represented. I just want more of those people to come with more and more frequency as well. There are things that we can do. One last point I'd make on the environment point on that is, it should be normative for live performances in Des Moines, across whatever that is, the gallery opening or a music performance, that we capture those digitally. And that then after we've captured them digitally, we work with great audio engineers and work with great video artists as well to create a compelling thing that shows up on everybody's screen. I don't care what screen it is. I'll give you a nice kind of way that this can play out. I grew up in the Quad Cities, and I watched our television stations over there do those painful segments where they brought a local chef to a fabricated set to show, hey, this is how we cook these things together, and they're featuring a really cool ingredient. And those did massively well for their time. But now the technology has changed. We have a big disruption as well. Now we have opportunities, and we see it on YouTube all the time, where chefs can not have to rely on that segment, but instead can do something in their home kitchen or some other place as well. That's just one example of a performed art culture now, where those chefs are going to these clips, going to that 2-minute video to show what great culinary art potentially looks like. How can we be doing that more frequently with the live music performances at the Social Club? How can we be meeting people in those places where they are spending all that time and putting their eyeballs all the time? That's another big investment, I think, that we need to think about making across the arts and culture venues, in particular, meeting people in those digital spaces with really rich.
I am really excited for the opportunity that Mainframe can exist here, and it's taking shape. When I moved back, I'm one of those that moved away for many years and moved back and really did not see an opportunity for me to be back in the arts field at Des Moines. And I've been back maybe 8 years now. But just in that time frame, how much that's changed. And the fact that not just be involved with the arts, but really be involved with this impactful project, I think it says a lot to Des Moines that Justin Mandelbaum saw it possible here in that persistence. I think he personifies the equality of Des Moines as a whole, like being able to be persistent, see the impact that it's going to take long term. Get the right people in line to make it happen, and that perseverance. I am giddy about the project that we're actually creating a space where art starts, where people have the ability to have room to create and work. So we're not going to be a performance center. We're not going to be, you know, this or that, but I think it's unique in Des Moines in the sense that these people will be creating new works of art, new pathways, new innovations, and the fact that they're going to be under one roof where they're going to be able to collaborate. And we have game developers lined up. We have illustrators that work with Warner Brothers. We have painters that are internationally acclaimed. We have photographers, commercial and fine art. We are going to have a shared use commercial kitchen, ceramicists, metal workers, glass blowers. I mean, that's pretty stunning. And I get to work with these people every day. I have those dialogues. I can't wait for Des Moines to be able to share the experience I'm having. And not just because it feels good, but these people, like Pete mentioned, they want to be challenged. They want to be motivated to extend and develop their career so they're really master craftsmen in their own medium. And how that's going to interact with the businesses around us and influence the walkability of the Northern Gateway to Des Moines. That's a huge thing that I really hope it develops quickly because of the changes in Northern Kia that's going to happen. And it's a little frightening to watch people trying to cross that street. You know,
it's a very visible sign, though, too.
It is. Yeah. And
people will know you're there.
Exactly.
Understand
now with the new windows going in today, physical transformations are starting. So I'm just glad that Des Moines is providing the campus for this to happen and being a part of the great attention that Des Moines is having, but also the Midwest and all the attributes that make us great.
Well, certainly from the partnership's perspective, we want to create this business environment, an economic environment that makes it possible for all of these businesses and organizations to thrive so that quality of life and talent and economic development all tie together. And so whatever we can do and however we can amplify that, both to incite that community pride locally and also to project that nationally and internationally so that people know, yeah, Mainframe Studios is not only a great thing for Des Moines, but by the way, it is the largest entity, nonprofit, artist space of its type in the country, right? So that makes us a national leader as well. So our call to action to our local community too would be to please be engaged and help us amplify that via social media, sign up to be a social ambassador with the partnership because we love to have those voices. And then putting on my musician's hat a little bit, I'd be remiss if I didn't give a shout out to the state and to the cities and to this wonderful, wonderful public-private partnership that exists here in our community that gives us this great sense of regionalism. The corporate environment here is such that they not only show up with their dollars, but they show up with their time. I mean, we see our CEOs, we see senior leadership at these top organizations that are volunteering their time to sit on these boards to help drive strategic direction for these organizations so that the boots on the ground can devise these incredible marketing campaigns to get people in the seats, to get artists in the doors. The people running those organizations are experts in that, and we're so fortunate to have this environment where it's so collaborative. I mean, the cities and their arts councils and their art trails and the corporations, it's a really, really great thing, and I can tell you from an artist's perspective, it's very unique.
Thank you all for your time. I know we went way over, but we couldn't stop, so I appreciate it. And to our audience, thank you for joining us. If anything today, we talked about spurred a story idea. We always say our best ideas always come from our audience. And so if something today gave you a thought or think of something that the Business Record or DSM Magazine, our sister publication, should be writing about, feel free to reach out to either myself or Perry Beeman. Our contact information will be on the screen for you. And then as well, Perry will be working to put together some thoughts on this on a story. It'll be something that if you watch this, you'll be able to share as well. So thank you again for joining us.